By this time, each of you should have received a letter outlining our planning that is a result of prayer as to how we're going to reopen our worship service on Sunday morning. A couple of things very quickly. Number one, in our meeting with the pastors and the deacons, we have decided that a mask is a must, or you can call it face covering, whatever you want to call it, as we worship in this coming Sunday morning. And as I said in the letter, if you forgot yours, please don't turn around in the parking lot. We have a limited supply that we can give to you. A mask is a must. And then we hope that you will come and you know, be a participant in the worship time. We look forward to a great time of celebration, trusting the Lord that he's going to protect us and his name will be glorified in the process. We look forward to seeing you. If you have any questions about the letter, please feel free to call the church office or call me. I will be glad to answer any questions that I can. Thank you, and God bless. Good morning. Once again, we are here to continue our worship. Let me invite you to the book of Acts, chapter 1. We'll be reading a rather lengthy passage today. Acts chapter 1, beginning at verse 10. We read to the end of that chapter. Again, Acts chapter 1. And when you find it, here's how it reads. And while they looked steadfastly toward the heavens as he went up, behold, two men stood by them with white apparels, which also said, "You men of Galilee, why stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven." Then they returned unto Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey. And when they were come into the city, they went into an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas Bartholomew, Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, "The number being about 120. Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spoke before concerning Judas, who was guided to them that took Jesus. For he was numbered with us and had obtained part of this ministry. Now, this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and all of his bowels just gushed out. It was known unto all the dwellers of Jerusalem, inasmuch as that field is called in their proper tongue Akeldama, that is to say, the field of blood. For it is written in the book of the Psalm, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take. Wherefore, of these men which have accompanied us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John unto that same day that he was taken up from us, must one be ordained to be witness with us of the resurrection? And they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "Thou, Lord, who knowest the hearts of all men, show whether which of these men you have chosen." And he made part of this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go on his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. May God bless to our hearts the reading of his word today. Now, I have chosen this particular passage of scripture to deal with in the light of our impending reopening of the sanctuary for worship. There is not much theological, implication impacted in here, except for the history of the church. Now, just so you know, the book of Acts really records the history of the church as it began and is advanced. Now, Jesus appeared to his apostles. Did you get that? His apostles, after the resurrection, at many places and in many different forms. Now, I use the word apostles because we use two words interchangeably. And they are apostles and disciples. The apostles are those who were actually chosen by Christ and served Christ and followed the ministry of Jesus Christ. A disciple is a learner. Now, every believer can be a disciple, but not every believer can be an apostle. And if I had the time this morning, I would tell you a little bit about the criteria for being an apostle, but we don't have the time for that this morning. But the 11 apostles had met Jesus outside of Jerusalem at the Mount of Olives. And at that point, Jesus gave them what we refer to in another way, the Great Commission. He says, you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and then ultimately unto the uttermost part of the earth. The scripture records that following that, Jesus ascended into heaven. Two men dressed in white apparel came and spoke to the 11 and said, stop gazing up into heaven, because this same Jesus you have seen taken up will return in like manner. Let me paraphrase, I think, what the implication is and what was said. Basically, God was reminding these men that they are now to get busy about the assignment that he had given to them. The scripture then tells us that that after that, they returned to Jerusalem, which means that they came from Jerusalem to meet Jesus at the Mount of Olives. They returned to Jerusalem. And when they returned to Jerusalem, it said that that they went up into an upper room. All right, let me help you here. It is said that this upper room was normally a third floor that was built on houses. It was usually used for dinner, for fellowship, and some have said that on occasion it was rented out to folk who could not afford a home. So it was actually a boarding room. We do not know exactly which upper room this was. There is a number of speculation about what it, for example, some have suggested that it was the same room in which Jesus held the Last Supper. But we really do not know. We have no clarification of that. But this we do know, that in that upper room, there were about 109 Christians, church members, waiting and praying. Why do I say that? If you look at the list, it lists the 11 apostles, minus Judas Iscariot, and then it says the total number was about 120. So they were in their gathering. And it says in verse 14 that they all continued with one accord. I like that. With one accord, they were in unison about their prayer concern. It does not tell us all that they were praying about, but the scripture said that they made supplication unto God. And then brother Peter stood up in those and said, "Men and brethren, we want you to know that the scripture needed to be fulfilled." In other words, there was no accident that that Judas did what he did in order to accomplish the prophecy of the Old Testament. And in those verses, he lists cites a lot of Old Testament scripture, particularly the Psalms, where it was predicted that that this would become a reality in the life of the church. Now, let me just stop here to say that one of the other apostles met his death through persecution. Judas met his death through suicide, actually. Now, for those of you who want to check further, it is said that Judas was replaced, but the other apostle was not replaced. And it's simply because Judas took his own life, somebody else took the other apostle's life. Now, it said also that after Peter had given the history of the need to fulfill the Old Testament prophecy, he said that they appointed two men, Joseph called Barsabbas and Justin, who was surnamed Justin, and Matthias. These two met the qualification. And in summary, here is the qualification. Whoever was to replace Judas had to meet certain qualifications. One of those qualifications was that they had to have known Jesus and followed Jesus and be involved with Jesus' ministry from his baptism to the ascension. And apparently, there were only two men in that group that met that qualification. Now, because the reason for this is that these men were to carry on the witness of Jesus Christ. So after they did that, they appointed the two. It says they prayed. And here is the prayer in verse 24. It says, "Lord, you who know the heart of all men, please, show us which of these two you have chosen to replace the one that is gone." And then it says that they gave forth their lots. Now, again, that's an interesting way to put it. Somebody said that in a jestful kind of a way that throw the dice. Now, what is this lot? In 1 Chronicles chapter 26, beginning at verse 13 and on, it tells us about this casting lot. And the best that I can figure out is that apparently they took some stones and put it into a container, a jar, and they shake up the stones and threw the stones. And whichever stone came out first, that was the winner. So they gave their lots, and it says that the lot fell upon Matthias, and then he was numbered with the 11 to make 12 apostles to carry on the work of Jesus Christ. Now, the question is, and I know you're going to ask me, what does this have to do with what we're trying to do here at the Southside Baptist Church? Two simple suggestions, then we'll be on our way. Two simple suggestions. Suggestion number one, as we read this text, a crisis has always been a part of the Christian church. Crisis has always been a part of the Christian church. And I was thinking about this journey that we have been on for the last 4 months, going 5 months now. In March of this year, we referred to the pandemic, the COVID-19. That has affected the world, has affected our nation, and has affected the church. Even today, the reality of the matter is the fact that it is still going on, and there is still a great deal of uncertainty about life for a whole lot of people. Here in the book of Acts, We find what I call the nucleus of the New Testament church confronted with a set of crises. Now, you notice I said a set of crises. Why do I say that? The immediate crises that they had to face was actually the replacement of Judas, who had taken his own life. But before we get that, in the backdrop of that is the crisis of fear of the people's lives. Now, why do I say that? Verse 12 tells us that they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, and they went up, which is a Sabbath day's journey. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they went into an upper room. What do you suppose these folk were doing in this upper room? Jesus, the hope of the Jews, the anticipated Messiah, the one who would come, in their opinion, riding on a white stallion, to deliver them from all of their oppressors and free them from all of the burdens that they bear, the taxes of the Roman government and all of the stuff that they were under. But Jesus came riding on a donkey, and he was tried in a court, accused of stuff he did not do. He was crucified, and he died on the cross. Now, watch this. The scripture said that Peter had said to the Lord, "Lord, I though everybody will forsake you, you can count on me. I will never forsake you." Jesus said to Peter, "Peter, be careful what you say. God, there's a time coming when before the cock crow three times, you're going to be denying me." Yeah, yeah. And in their minds, I suspect that what they were saying is, if they do that to our leader, mm-hmm. what are they going to do with me? And obviously that they were in the upper room praying, but I believe they were hiding. They were afraid of their lives, for their lives. And then it tells us about the replacement of Judas. The replacement of Judas, it says in verse 18, look at what he says. He said, "Now this man purchased a field with the rewards of his iniquity." And it says, "And falling headlong, Lord have mercy, he burst asunder in the midst, and all of his bowels gushed out." Now watch this. I am going to suggest that a crisis can be messy for the church. Can be awfully messy. Now, I don't mean to be ugly, but I'm just kind of repeating what the scripture says. Now, we know that Judas intentionally killed himself. But the scripture here describes it as a very messy act. Now, how do I know that it's messy? I don't know what folk think of, for example, when they decide to take their own lives. But as best as I can understand, most of the stuff is somewhat messy, but they're kind of a delicate about it. The scripture said that Judas plunged headfirst. Now, we do not know exactly where he jumped from. Was it an overpass? Was it a high-rise building? Was it on top of a car? Was it a mountain? We know that he intentionally went down with force. Let me tell you how forceful it was. The scripture says that as he hit, his body exploded all over the place. Now, why am I sharing this with you? The last 3 months, 4 months, we have gone through some messy stuff. Hundreds of thousands of people died. Some lives are changed for the rest of their lives. It's something that has changed our lives, not only for time, but for eternity. Please notice that these crises are not always messy, only always messy, but they're also filled with fear. Now, that brings me to stop preaching, start meddling for just a little bit. Under the leadership, I believe, of the Holy Spirit, we have made a decision. The leadership of this church has decided that after a period of hiatus, working and worshiping outside of the four walls of this facility, we will again trust God to come back together as a body of believers. Now, I know. Please notice, as we have said, we are inviting you, as many as feel comfortable. But I'm listening, and the reality of the matter is there are still some who are very much afraid. And I can understand this, but the reality of the matter is we cannot and we should not continue to let fear run our lives. Because the reality of the matter is, we have a choice to make. It's fear or trusting God. Now watch this, and I'm going to be, let me be very candid with you. I'm not asking you to be stupid. I'm not asking you to be irresponsible. We're not asking you to be careless. But we're asking you to use the brain that the Lord has given to you and to me to do everything possible to make sure that we walk in the will of God, in the guidance of God, trusting God that He will lead us, He will protect us, He will defend us in every way. We ought not to let a fear lead our lives. The scripture says that the number that was in the upper room praying was about 120. That's a nice sized congregation to be working with. But they were there because of fear. But we're going to be talking about some other things. Now, so the crisis always is messy. And then the crisis can control our lives by fear. But there's something else in this passage that spoke to me. That crisis ought to motivate the church to some kind of action. Crisis ought to motivate the church to some kind of action. All the way through this passage of scripture, it refers to the fact that the people of God were praying. And in fact, when they came to the replacement of Judas, Peter stood up and watch this in verse 27. It didn't say Peter prayed. It says they prayed and saying, God, you who know the heart of everybody, you know our hearts, you know the heart of the men that have been put forth, please show us which one of these men you want us to set aside to fill the place of Judas. Now, watch this. When I talk about prayer, very often, somebody would say to me, preacher, I want you to pray for me. I want you to pray for me. Most of the time, when it comes to believers, church members, you know what I say? I say, I'll be glad to pray with you. Because if you believe in the power of prayer, you ought to be exercising that privilege that the Lord gives to you. The scripture tells us that when we come to the Father in prayer, we ought not to come with fear and trembling, but we ought to come with a sense of familiarity. We ought to come with a sense of confidence. We ought to come with a sense of faith, saying, Abba, Father. You know what that means? Daddy, would you do this for me? And you ought to ask, you ought not to be asking Daddy for anything that you know Daddy is not going to give to you. So, first of all, in a crisis situation, the church ought to pray. Now, watch this. I also believe that it wasn't a matter that they were praying at this point only. I believe that prayer was a real part of their lives. Because if you remember, at one point, I think it's in Matthew chapter 6, the disciples came and said to him, Lord, just teach us how to pray. They sensed that Jesus had an extraordinary connection with the Heavenly Father, and they wanted to have that. We need a relationship with God so that we can intercede on our behalf and on behalf of other people. Pray. Plan. Not now. Is that what the scripture said? Or am I misreading the thing? Peter got up and he said to the church, he said, brethren, it's time for us to replace Judas. He said, obviously, Judas was ordained through prophecy that this would happen. But in order to complete the circle, we need to replace him. Watch this. And he outlined to them what the necessary qualification for the replacement of this apostle that had broken the circle was. What I am trying to say is, as I read and dealt with it, the Holy Spirit of God said to me that planning is necessary. So sometimes and too often, we do what Mama would call shooting from the hip. We don't do any praying. We don't do any planning. We just jump and do. And when it's all over, we said, I should have thought that through. Now, Southside Baptist Church, I want you to know that we have done a lot of praying about this matter. We have done a lot of planning. In fact, just this week, the deacons and the pastors met. And we were here for over an hour and a half talking about how our coming back together will affect us as a church family, how we will do everything within our power to assure the safety of those who feel free to come back into the house of the Lord to worship the Lord in unison. How we will handle coming in and going out and making it safe for everybody to be in here, calling it, quote, social distancing. We thank you, Lord. We have done all of the planning that we believe is necessary. And I believe that we have prayed our way through this, and we are trusting God that God will send us back, and on July the 12th when we gather, I'm not even sure I'm going to preach. Yeah, I'll let you do the preaching about God's goodness and God's mercy and God's protection and God's deliverance, what God has done for us in the midst of crisis, because remember, he got this. He's in control. He knows what he is doing and why he is causing this to be a part of our life. Maybe, just maybe, he might want to just draw us a little bit closer to him. And then finally, the scripture says that after they had prayed and after they had planned, they acted. Now watch this. I laugh when the scripture says they cast their lots. But they did something about it. Now, brothers and sisters, let me tell you what the adversary would like to do. He would just like to get us in his grip of fear, so that we don't do anything. You know what? He doesn't want us here praising the Lord. He doesn't want us out there witnessing to the glory of God. He doesn't want us testifying to the power of God. As long as he get us in the grip of fear and keep us from doing what we ought to be doing, his mission's been accomplished. But now watch this. It says, they cast their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias. Now, brethren, sisters, those of you who don't know, have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, if we continue to live in fear, we will never do what God wants us to be doing. But I believe, to the glory of God, we'll move on. And I believe that if we continue to plan and continue to exercise caution, that God will protect and God will be glorified. Now watch this. You know me, and you know what I'm going to say now. I'm going to say that if you are outside of Jesus Christ, all of this that I'm trying to say to you, a mama would say it's like water on a duck's back. It just kind of a sliding right off. But you know something? Can I just give a personal word of testimony right here? See, the work to which God has called me has placed me in quote scientific terms in a precarious position. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the fact that you may call me and say, Pastor, my child is in the hospital. My wife is in the hospital. Somebody died. You know what? Today, because of our life situation, you know, Mrs. Downs received a kidney, praise the Lord, a week ago. And I have to be careful how I respond to those kinds of requests. But in general, using the little bit of common sense that I have, the Lord has protected me beyond my expectation. Wouldn't you just give God a chance? There's a thing called faith. Faith is, in simple terms, believing that God can do what I can't do. Believing that God can go where I can't go. But unless you are in a relationship with God, you won't understand this. Let me tell you how it works. If you put it in a biological test tube faith, it's not going to make any sense to you. If you try to put it in a biological test tube, your relationship with God is not going to make any sense to you. Yeah. When I was in Little Rock, Arkansas, part of the ministry that I had was to run a health clinic and minister to some youth from the project. This one little fellow, I mean, he was such a rascal. He would stir up trouble anywhere and everywhere he shows up. The Lord sent into the little church that I was trying to pastor a young man who had a black belt in karate. And he said to me, he said, "Pastor," he said, "do you think I could work with some of these boys and minister to them through karate? I mean, if these boys want to fight all the time, you know, we'll show them how to do it in a Christian kind of a way, defend themselves." I said, "Let's do it." It was about 1 o'clock in the morning. I heard a knock on the glass on my window next to the bedroom. I said, "Who is knocking at my door 1 o'clock in the morning?" And I kind of ignored it, and there was a knock again. When I went to the window, who was there? That same little boy. The young man from church had taken him out to ice cream, and won him to the Lord. And he could not wait until the sun rose to let me know what God had done for him. Life completely changed. When some bad boys were hanging around the facility, and Mr. Eddie and I had to take the kids back to the project. When we came back to the house, that young man and about four others were just hanging around. And the minute Mr. Eddie and I came in, they just kind of began to leave one by one. Mr. Eddie said to me, he said, "You know what, Reverend?" He said, "They knew that you and I were away and our wives were in there. They wanted to make sure no mischief occurred while we were out." That's the kind. See, God can transform a life. Only He can do it. And when He does that, we won't have to live our lives in fear. But we can honor and glorify God. Do you know Jesus as your personal Savior? If you don't, why not let's talk about it? I'll be glad to hear from you. You know how to reach me. Call the church office. I'll be listening for your call. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. We want to step out on faith to glorify your matchless name, to let the world know that you're still alive and you're doing well. Father God, as we come to the point where we gather your saints one more time to celebrate your goodness and your mercy, we pray that you will teach us how to walk in confidence, to know that you are God. If there's somebody here who is listening to my voice today, who's never come into a personal relationship with you, I pray that this will be the day when they'll reach out, Father, and say, "Lord, save me." And then I can't wait till the day breaks to tell somebody what you've done for me. All of this we pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Thank you. as we gather to observe the ordinance of the Lord's Supper one more time, we invite you to worship with us if you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, cleansed by the blood, sealed by the Holy Spirit unto the day of redemption. We invite you to participate in this portion of the worship. The scripture tells us that on the eve of his crucifixion, Jesus met in the upper room with his apostles for what we believe was the feast of the Passover. The scripture says, supper being ended, Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks. This morning, as we gather for remembering the sacrificial work of Christ on the cross, we're going to ask Reverend Jerry Martin if he would lead us in our prayer of thanksgiving for the broken body of Jesus Christ. Let's pray.
Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to come and to break bread together in commemoration of what you did on the cross. We thank you, Lord, that your sacrifice has made a way for us to have life eternal. Mm-hmm. We pray that you would judge our hearts and our minds and have our spirits connected to your spirit, Lord, yes. That we would appreciate what you have done for us. Bless this bread now, we do pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And the scripture says that when he had thus prayed, he broke the bread and he gave it to his apostle. We'll follow his example. Jesus said to his apostles in the upper room, "This is my body which is broken for you." If you remember, the scripture in the Old Testament predicted that not one bone in his body would be broken, but that his body would be plunged asunder. You and I know the story of the crucifixion. How as the soldiers came by to verify death through the breaking of the bone, when they came to Jesus, they did not. But the scripture says that he took a sword and plunged it into the side of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, admonishes them that when they come to do the Lord's Supper, they ought to come with a spirit of worship. And he said unto them, "As often as you do this, you show forth the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us eat this morning with thanksgiving that his body was broken on Calvary in order that ours may be made whole in eternity. This scripture says that in like manner, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it. And we're going to follow his example this morning as Reverend Stan Williams lead us in a prayer of thanksgiving for the shed blood of Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. In the name of Jesus, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the shed blood. Lord, you said in your word that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin.
Yes, Lord.
We come thanking you for Jesus' blood, which he voluntarily gave that we might have the right to the forgiveness of sins, mm-hmm. that we might have the right to be called the sons and daughters of God, and that we might have wholeness, healing, and completeness, and transformation. Lord, help us to be a people who are willing to be just that sacrificial in our living, as modeled by our Savior. We thank you in Jesus' name.
And the scripture said that when he had thus prayed, he gave it to his apostles, and we're going to follow his example. Jesus said to his apostles, this is my blood, which is shed for the remission of sins. As we've heard, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. But the poet understood it well when he says, not all the blood of beasts on Jewish altar slain could give a guilty conscience peace. But glory be to God, the blood of Jesus Christ still stands as a fountain that flows eternally. And the Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, admonished them as we would be admonished by the Holy Spirit today. As often as you drink this cup, you proclaim his death and he come until he comes again. Let us drink with thanksgiving that his blood was shed that we might inherit eternity. And the scripture says, when they were finished, they sung a hymn and they went out. Remember, the Heavenly Father is counting on you to make him look good. When your light shines and my light shines, God looks good through us, we will be looking.